Barbershop Podcast, coming to you from Box O Studio, Hamilton, Ontario, the source of the kind of music I know you're going to want to hear night after night. I do. Every week, I am so thrilled to have some of the greatest artists in here inspiring me with what they do and how they do it. Ryan, 369 days ago, we launched our very first episode on attempt number three
with
Mr. Peter Arsenal.
On the failed CD burner.
Yeah, and we recording lured, set up. Crawled that ladder, got to the point where it's this incredible technical innovation that we are bringing to you. And one more innovation, one more step on the ladder is a new sponsor that we're welcoming on the show tonight. Jamie and fellas, Chris and Jack and everyone, we're Andrew working over at Picks and Sticks on Lock Street in Hamilton, Ontario. Jamie is a friend of the show, a fan of the show. He totally gets it, and being part of the community, he is very excited about joining with the show, sponsoring some performances, helping us do more each and every week to spread the word about the kind of great stuff that we've got here in Hamilton. So we want to thank Picks and Sticks for coming along for this episode. And Ryan, it's a beauty, isn't it?
Yeah, it's, we've been waiting for this one.
Yeah, and I gotta say, I've been banging on her door for a while and finally got her in. I'm proud of myself. Lori Yates, thank you so much for coming and making it into the show and making this place shine the way you do. How you doing?
Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's great. It's great. So the long, hard work that you've put in, all of the years, all the sweat and toil, I guess it's paid off because you're finally here.
Absolutely. It's all come to this moment.
Moment in time. Well, I'm thrilled because, you know, again, for people who are in the musical community or people who have been around who have a taste for it and will seek out music, they're well aware of who you are and your story. But there's so many people who haven't had the opportunity to go out and see live music and don't have the luck of having a friend who can point them in the direction of a nice search engine or something to expose the music. And we're trying to do that right here at Barbershop Podcast. And I'm thrilled that you brought in some of your discography and your guitar and your wonderful voice.
Oh, thank you.
Now, I get the feeling that music has been more than background music for you, probably from the very, very early days.
Absolutely. Always a really big part of my life. Loved it. Always was singing, you know, as the kid who was always in the corner, talking away, singing away. Really vividly remember being like 8 years old in the basement washroom with my friend talking about, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? Well, I can't remember what she wanted to be, but I vividly remember saying that I want to be either a Playboy bunny or a singer.
Excellent.
Hey, and I'm both, folks. I fulfilled my dreams.
Yeah. Well, you know, and again, we'll touch on that. That's part of it, that we come from an era where it was all about the music. Totally. You had no idea what these people looked like. Yeah. And I remember recently it was a greatest hits of the 70s. And they're showing, you know, Seals and Croft and Christopher Cross and, you know, these people. And I have to admit, I looked and said, how did these people get a record contract, you know? And then I said, how terrible, you know, that we've been kind of conditioned that video did kill the radio star to a certain extent.
Absolutely.
But what the music does to you, you know, before there's any kind of visual stimulus whatsoever, is pretty fantastic.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and it still happens, you know, like it happened to me not so long ago. I guess last year around Christmas, I was vacuuming upstairs on my second floor, listening to, I don't know, CBC or something. The song came on and literally stopped me in my tracks. I'm like, and I stood there and I stood there. And it was Lana Del Rey, who I'd read some hype about her. Maybe I'd seen her picture. She was a beautiful gal, but I didn't put any of that together when I'd heard the song. It was just the melody, the vocal, the words, the sound of it, and it, you know, literally stopped me in my tracks. And I was thrilled that that could still happen, right?
Yeah.
With tunes that, you know, I was so intrigued, like literally just stood there paralyzed.
Well, I want to get into how you process music, because it's become part of your life, and mm-hmm. and not only is it a passion, but it's been a business
yeah.
with you. I want to go back. When was the first time when you actually put yourself on a stage or put yourself in front of people?
Well, it was at the...
And we're not talking about the Playboy Bunny.
That never happened.
It's still you weren't at Hef's Club slinging drinks.
You know? No, but I was in one band that we used to open up for these strippers, but they were male strippers. And I'm telling you, those women did not want to hear me sing. And the guys in the band were not that cute. It was a really hellish gig. It was mean. They were mean, those women. They were after those male strippers. No, I started a little truck stop on Highway 27, sort of north of Toronto, 727, called Joe's Truck Stop, in a cover band, a little cover band called Senseless. And there were these guys from Woodbridge with the bass player who, Louis Yaknin, he had played in Lighthouse. Was it Lighthouse? Yeah. So this gig for him was, he just wanted to get, you know, stoned out of his gourd and play and mm-hmm. have like this little chick singing up front, which was me. So I think I was, I don't know, 17 or 18. Place was packed, you know, the toilets overflowed, a fight broke out, I lost my voice. It was fantastic. Perfect. I loved it. And they paid me. They gave me money at the end of the night.
Were you doing covers or was it original music?
No, it was all covers at that point. It was doing like Blondie mm-hmm. and Pretenders and Joan Jett. Well, it wouldn't have been Joan Jett, maybe the Runaways.
Right.
And that was my first gig. And then I started a band in the city, Toronto, where I was from, an original band, a punky new wave band called The Last Resorts. And I started to write with them. And we played, you know, the Turning Point. I think we were the last band to play the Turning Point.
Yeah, what was the club scene like at that time? Because it really went through a couple major... you know, it had a lot to do with the drinking age yeah. and when it would go up and when it would go down and where you were geographically in the city.
It was pretty good. I mean, I don't know. We played at Larry's a lot. We opened for the MC5 at Larry's. Our main goal was to open for Teenage Head.
Right.
Right, who was like my favorite band and the band's favorite band. And even our bass player wanted us to be managed by Jack Douglas. Right?
Yeah.
Which is kind of funny looking back now. But it seemed to be, you know, we played the Cabana Room all the time. There seemed to be a lot of places for original music at that time. When we would venture out to the road, we went to Arundale College in mm-hmm. Mississauga, and that's where we actually got to open for Teenage Head, and which was pretty fantastic.
Now, how did the writing process come along for you? Did you kind of get thrust in that role, or did you pick away at it?
Well, you know what? As soon as I picked up a guitar, was right around that band, when that band started, a friend of mine said, okay, here's three chords, write a song. That way you'll remember the chords, and I started writing right away. So, yeah. And then within that band, we did some covers. We did some Supremes, and then we did originals. So just started writing and always wrote from that point forward.
And again, those you touched on it, that it was a kind of like an edgy, punky band. People mm-hmm. know you now more as a country songster. Yeah. So that goes with the maturation process where you start falling in love with all these different forms of music. Did you can you pinpoint a time more or less when it became kind of this cornucopia, this giant buffet that it's like I want to dive in, or were you very directed in what you wanted to do in those early days?
Like, you know what, in those early days, even before then, even when I was like 13, 14, I kind of, you know, I heard country music in my home a bit. Johnny Cash, Johnny Rivers, although Johnny Rivers isn't country, but I was hanging around these kids at Keel and Wilson. There was these Newfie kids and East Coasters, Brenda and Johnny and Dickie and Paulette, and they all listened to country music, but they not in any kind of make fun of it way. So, you know, I got hooked, because as much as I wanted to sound like the guy from Moxie or Janis Joplin, I didn't sound like that when I sang. I could sound like Tanya Tucker or Dolly Parton, and I just loved it. And you know, a vivid memory is like being in the back of Brendan Dickey's car with their parents, and this would have been like, you know, 74, so the Beehives and the DuckTales were kind of long gone, but not really for their parents, right? And they had some kind of like big car with you know, fins on it, and some big black car, and you know, Merle Haggard's I'm a Lonesome Fugitive came on the radio, and it was just like, oh, just burned into my memory, and just loved it. So, you know, I'd be listening to country music with them, and then Dark Side of the Moon and Moxie and Patti Smith and David Bowie as well. And so with the first band, there's pictures of me at Larry's Hideaway, and I'm wearing a Western shirt. Like, it always was there because I could sing it.
Right.
I think that's why. So, you know, forward a few years later, and I decided that I wanted to put together kind of a cowpunk band. Wasn't really sure how to do that, so I put some ads in the paper.
Yeah, was anyone else doing it, or was this something in your...
Well, I think they were, but not... yeah, they were, definitely, because this was like, you know, Queen Street, Toronto, 84, 85.
Were you living right down there at that time?
Yeah. I was living 762 Queen Street West, and my apartment had a hole in the floor, and I could look into my neighbors. And on the second floor was a kind of a skid, was like a skid flop house for, you know, that's what it was.
You remember what the rent was?
It was cheap, and it had a lot of bugs. But you know what? We could rehearse there, and the thing was the main... door coming up didn't have a lock, so all the guys, all the rubbies that were going in the main floor, they occasionally would pass out in the hall, and so you couldn't open your door, right? And there'd be people coming up the back stairs, and it was wild. But my drummer lived downstairs, I lived on the top, the other singer lived on the other side, and then the rubbies lived down there.
So it truly were the halcyon days.
It was
that's
fantastic.
When you were cutting your teeth.
Yeah, totally.
And Queen Street at that time was really when it came to life.
Was, like Handsome Ned was big. I guess Blue Rodeo were just starting, my band and me. So there was definitely a scene. There were, you know, there were the rockabilly kids. There were kids wearing the cowboy boots and the Western shirts, and it was sort of happening.
Now, do you remember where you were the first time you heard one of your songs on the radio?
Yeah, I was at 30 Fuller Avenue.
People always remember.
I was cooking, so that in itself is memorable. I was a person that would put corningware on the top of the stove, and like, how come it broke? I didn't know it was supposed to go in the oven. Anyways, but I was cooking something, and on it came. It was CFGM, which is the equivalent to CHAM. In Toronto, and it was a song called Sweetheart Avenue, and I literally fell to my knees and rolled around on the floor and screamed, and yeah, I just couldn't believe it. A
magic moment for
sure.
Absolutely,
yeah.
And something, again, I have to pull out that some people don't maybe know about you, is like you were on the Super Dave Osborne show. And that, I think, has got a... Did you know that, Ryan, that she was on the Super Dave Osborne show?
I had no idea, but... I love that show.
We all did.
I probably saw it because I'm sure I've watched every episode as a kid. I loved that show.
So how did that come about? Because it really was to struggle to find yourself a venue where you could play and be heard. Like SCTV was doing it, and Super Dave Osborne show as well with John Biner. How did that come your way?
It must have come because of my first record, first major record with Sony Nashville was a big American record deal, and so then a lot of attention. I got a lot of attention, a lot of gigs, and must have come through that. I remember doing the gig, and it was bizarre because it was in front of a live audience, but I was singing to tracks, so it's me singing live, but there's no band with me, right? Just there, and I have, like, hair extensions. I have big, long, red hair extensions, and I'm kind of like, you know... So, and honestly, it plays every 6 months, and I get like a few pennies for it, but every 6 months it comes on. I'm like, oh, there it is. It was great. At the time, I had recorded a song called Blue Side of Town, which when I recorded it in Nashville, it was, I think Rosie Flores had recorded it, and they held my record for a year. And in the space of that year, Patti Loveless had come out with Blue Side of Town, the same song. It had gone to number one. So suddenly it looked like I had recorded a cover song, which at the time I hadn't, but it suddenly looked like I did. So Super Dave really wanted me to record, to perform that song, and I bucked, and I was like, I'm not doing that song. I'm not doing it. I'll look like I'm doing a cover song. I'm an original artist, have a new record. So we got into a bit of a tussle over it, and I didn't do it. I wasn't going to do it.
So as looking back on it now, in your early days when you first got that phone call, you first got that first record deal, mm-hmm. and back then there were such a thing a record deal.
There were, yeah.
And it's kind of legend and lore now with the way that the industry has turned. But how did getting that first deal change your life?
Musically, well, it suddenly opened up. It became a full-time job,
right?
Until then, I was working in social work and gigging, you know, 4 or 5 nights a week, falling asleep at my desk, and you know, making pretty good money because I was getting popular. But it let me quit that job, and I was telling a friend of mine the other day that. I had this boss who was amazing, right? Because every couple months I'd come to her and go, that's it, I'm quitting. I can't handle it. You know, I'm doing too many gigs. And she'd say, how are you going to live? How are you actually going to make money? I'm like, oh. So then I wouldn't quit. So finally I came to her and I said, look, Nina, they're flying me to New York. And she said, who's paying for the ticket? I said, Sony is. Who's paying for your hotel room? Sony is. Where's the hotel room? Oh, it's off of Central Park. She said, okay, now's a good time to quit.
Yeah, good sage advice.
Yeah, she did. Yeah.
Good sage advice. Yeah. And bumpy road along the way as far as finding your way with management and all the things that go, because you have to, you know, you trust the people in the community and you kind of learn by your mistakes. But it really does eat up quite a number of people in the process.
Well, you know, it to be a solo artist, I think, you know, kind of looking back retrospectively, you need a really strong sense of ego. You need a really burning desire to want to kind of be on top and number one. So I had some of that. I didn't have it completely. Part of my thing was, you know, my family was in Canada and I didn't want to leave them. And I wasn't seeing enough of a pull, as much as, you know, people now would say, oh my God, it's a big record deal. And it was. To kind of go on my own and leave everything behind here that I knew, including, you know, my boyfriend at the time who I loved, I couldn't do it. I just couldn't do it. So I did some of it. And, you know, the thing with a situation like that, you know, there's management involved. They set me up with an accountant. Like, it was all big. It was intimidating.
Yeah.
It really intimidated the crap out of me. And you know, I was fairly young, and I, you know, have a very much a shy side to myself, even though nobody believes that anymore. It's true, I do. And I was really quite shy then. So, and I, you know, had all the stuff that often artists have, you know, where it's running through your head. Oh, am I any good? Like, all that self-worth crap that often, you know, we become artists and we get in front of people because of that.
Yeah.
And then sometimes it gets a little too overwhelming, those insecurities, right? And they'll get the best of it.
And the pressure is being put on because now you have the deal.
And it is. And there is. And you're led to believe that maybe you have some control. You don't have any. You're dealing with a big, huge company that's basically going to tell you what to do.
Nashville, you've got a long association with it, and obviously, you know, a love affair. What was the first foray down to Nashville? Was it all go to the grind?
It was fantastic. It was very, you know, kind of magical and mythical, and you know, for some reason, you sing country music, and it's Mecca, right? That's where you're supposed to go, and. But they have like funny little things, like the producer that I ended up working with, you know, his voice came on the jukebox or something. He's like, do you know who that is? I'm like, no. He said, well, you better know who that is. That's Ernest Tubb. And I'm like, I didn't know. I mean, I knew who he was, but I couldn't identify the voice. Yeah. But there was like a bit of the country music police going on a little bit with that, right? But many, you know, really, really great experiences that at the time Kevin, honestly, I didn't understand the magnitude. I really didn't. Like, one night, there we were, the A&R guy, who's like a real, you know, wild party man, who's
just like they write them,
yeah. Like, really. And he's signing all the alternative country bands, and, you know, they're all freaking out at the head office over him. We're sitting in the lobby of the hotel. It's me, my manager, somebody else, and this guy comes along, and he's talking, and Larry says, "You know who that is?" And I said, "No, I don't know who that is." He goes, "That's Bob Johnson, you know, live at Folsom Prison, Route 66, or Highway 66, whatever, that Dylan record." I'm like, "Really?" He said, "Yeah, do you want to record with him?" I'm like,
"Apparently so."
I said, "Okay, well, let me make a few phone calls." Off he goes. Next thing you know, we're at a studio. What do I know? It's Cowboy Jack Clement's studio. It's midnight. Who's the band? Who's the guitar player, the mandolin player? Well, it's Marty Stewart.
Wow.
Yeah. And you know, Cowboy Jack Clement, he's like, "So we had a little band in here, you know, the other day from Ireland. They cut a song called Angel from Harlem."
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was pretty. So, but it was so kind of, I was just gobsmacked, yeah. Beyond gobsmacked. I had a friend back in Toronto, a journalist named Jim Holt, and I would phone him, and I'd say, "Jim, there was many of those, right? Many of those, like being, you know, at one point they said, "Hey, do you want to go to Austin, to South by Southwest?" I'm like, "Fucking right, I do, man. Yeah. Like, you're paying the ticket, I'm going." The manager I was with, I wasn't signed to him. He was freaking out. "How dare you go down there without me?" I'm like, "I'm going."
Yeah.
The first night there, first time I ever drank Jack Daniels, I didn't know.
Whiskey's whiskey.
Gets you in a lot of trouble. We're in a hotel room, the guitar's going around, right? And again, the A&R guy has brought me. I'm his new little find from Canada, up north, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm a northerner, right? So they're all kind of looking at me like, "What's that all about?" Guitar's going around. I go in the washroom. I'm like, okay, I got to remember my chords. You know, I got to remember, because I know it's going to come to me. And I know, even though this is all fun, everybody's drunk and partying, this is a test.
Serious.
This is the shit, right? Yeah. So, okay, so I do one song, it's good. The second song, it's a real belter. I'm belting away. My voice is really hoarse and raunchy and hitting all the notes. And everybody's grooving. And I look, there's a guy, he's playing along with me. I'm like, "I don't know who that guy is," whatever. And I blow the place away, right? And the guy beside me is like, "You're fantastic, man. It's really good." "My name's Jerry Jeff." "Who's Jerry Jeff Walker?" Yeah. I'm like, "Oh,
of course."
Right? And then the rumor was, "Wow, you know, your little girl did great. She blew everybody away," right?
Yeah, and she's so cool. It's like she didn't even know who he was.
Well, that was part of my problem. Yeah. See, I wasn't actually intimidated by people because I didn't know who they were.
Worked in your benefit.
I knew their names,
yeah.
And I knew a little of their story. But when I went to Nashville, the first writer I worked with was Carl Jackson. He's in Emmylou Harris's Angel Band.
Nice.
I was like, "I don't know."
Yeah, I went in on that.
Yeah, he's right, yeah.
Well, I want to get to music because you're going to sing and play live for us, and we're going to play some stuff that you've recorded in the studio. I think we're going to start off with a couple tracks off of Breaking Point. It was recorded in 1994. What are your recollections about recording that?
This one was a Virgin record that Colin Linden and John Wynott produced for me. We did a bunch of it at Sony in Toronto, even though I was signed to Virgin and Sony had dropped me. I don't know why we did, but we did. And also Bearsville, went down to Bearsville and recorded and mixed down there. So it was really cool.
It was a good, the whole process went smoothly.
It was fantastic.
Yeah, yep. Colin Linden's just amazing,
yeah.
Isn't he?
Yeah.
Great. And the song itself, Little Darlin', anything you want to tell us about this?
One I wrote, and you know, it was one of those ones that I liked, and I didn't know if anybody else would like. And then I played it for a couple of friends, and they were like, "Hey, that's a sweet song, man. You should record it." So I did, and I still like make money from it,
right.
But I'm pretty convinced they've got it mixed up with, you know, the 500 other songs that are called Little
Which
Darling.
Which is good enough.
And, you know, I'm like, "Hey, soak it, all right."
Well, yeah. This is Laurie Yates' version, Little Darling from Breaking Point here at barbershoppodcast.com.
Hey, little darling, why you crying? You never ever had. There's
Little Darling off of 1994's Breaking Point. Laurie Yates in the studio with us. I have to ask, what was it and when was it that you finally came to Hamilton from Toronto? Because it must have been a tough decision because Toronto was really happening.
Yeah.
What were the factors?
Well, the factors were I had a kid and suddenly wanted to have a patch of land, and that I was looking at, you know, maybe a two-bedroom apartment in Toronto and working full-time, which I didn't want to do. And a friend of mine told me he was moving out here, and I was like, really? He said, yeah. Have you checked out, like, you know, real estate in Hamilton? I'm like, no. I only knew of Hamilton was Teenage Head, of course. Yeah. Junk House, of course.
And the view from the highway.
Well, you know, I had played here twice, and when I first moved here, people didn't believe me. I sounded like such a blowhard, right? I'd be like, yeah, I played here before. I'm like, where? I'm like, well, I actually played at Cops Coliseum. Like, I did. I opened for Dwight Yoakam, right?
Yeah.
And the Festival of Friends. So yeah. Those, and I think a place called Dallas I played
yes,
once.
Yes, remember right? it well.
But my first, so, you know, I thought, okay, we're going to come and check out Hamilton, see what it's like. So February afternoon, pushing the baby carriage down Bold. I'm like, where is everybody, man? Like, it's cold. And it's...
We tend to roll up the sidewalks in Hamilton at 6 well, o'clock sometimes.
You know, it just was maybe not what I was used to. So I'm just walking, and I look up at this balcony, and I see Frankie Venom. I'm like, oh my God, there's Frankie Venom. I said, Gary, there's Frankie Venom, right, to my husband. And he's like, he doesn't know who he is. I'm like, you don't understand. Like, I'm kind of freaking out. Now, I've met Frank 100 times. He never remembers who I am, and I'm not about to go, hey, Frank! It's Lori from Toronto. You know, I'm not, right? Yeah. But I just took it as a sign. I really did. There was no one else around. We came there to kind of check out the city. My favorite band growing up, my favorite front man who, you know, I learned so much from, there he was. I'm like, okay, Hamilton, I'm going to come.
Yeah.
You know, and I think I was like one of the early ones that came because people were, they couldn't figure out. They're like, you moved here from Toronto? I'm like, yeah. You know?
Yeah, a lot of people call it Lakeshore West,
right.
West.
Right.
Because it's kind of an extension of that part of Toronto. And, you know, the GTA, for those of you watching in different parts of the world, you know, it's Toronto's fifth biggest city in North America now. But certainly, really? You know, yeah, the largest city in Ontario, and Hamilton would be a pretty big city if it was any other place. But when you're in Toronto's shadow, a lot of times... you don't get the props and you don't get the recognition, but it does attract the artists who are always not being compensated to the extent right. that they should be. And they're eventually driven out. The people who want to come in, it's happening now with the condos in Toronto where all these restaurants and everything are getting torn down to build the condos mm-hmm. and the people came to the condos to go into those neighborhoods in the first place, which is defeating it. And people, you know, and I have to say the city is benefiting from an influx of the creative types.
Well,
let's hope that they just put a lid on at a certain point where you have to have some sort of creativity test before you come in.
Not like you, creativity test, yeah, for sure.
So your voice is really quite remarkable. Is it something that you train formally for, or is that have you always had that kind of punch and power?
Well, I could always, you know, I'm loud, but that's from singing with bands for years, right? You
PAs.
Have to. Yeah. You know, is there a good PA? Like, I mean, anyways. But I've also trained, like, taken singing lessons out of necessity because I was losing my voice a lot. And, you know, you gotta, if you want to survive.
Did you change your style at some point?
No. You know what? At one point, I really wanted to be a 300-pound black woman. That's what I think I was born to do. However, I'm not. And so I had to stop singing like that or trying to sing like that and really find my own voice. So at one point, I was in serious trouble. I had lost my voice. I had nodes. I was looking at surgery. And I went to a singing coach who said, okay, you know what? You're allowed to do one trick a night. You can do one growl, or you can do one rockably, you know, one trick. Yeah. That's it. And then now you have to sing in your real voice, in your natural voice, because I was singing everything like this, which is kind of okay, but it's a bit of a mark of an immature singer as well. So once I stopped doing that, my voice problems kind of went away, and I don't really try and push, but I have a loud voice. Yeah.
Well, we're gonna hear it, because that's a wonderful segue into you're gonna see a little bit of what you do really so well and what Ryan does so well, which is mix music here at Boxo Studio. Please play one for us.
Here we go. I got mixed up somewhere. I forgot what was important. In the sober morning air, I can see where I went wrong. Thought this love would last, and it would never tire. Now the die has been cast. You're making plans to leave. Of the corner of my like a shadow passing quickly out of the corner of my eye. In a moment you were gone. Can't believe I didn't try, and I let you slip on by out of the corner of my eye. I'm living with ghosts. I'm haunted by your memory. The thing I wanted the most, well, it's not inside for me. Out of the corner of my like a shadow passing quickly out of the corner of my eye. In a moment you were gone. Can't believe I didn't try, and I let you slip on by out of the corner of my eye. Out of the corner of my eye. Out of the corner of my eye.
Beautiful job, Lori Yates, a real professional here, Barbershop Podcast. So, the people that you must have met over the years boggles the mind. I imagine. Seriously, I'm boggling.
I don't know.
Do you remember the again being gobsmacked? You know, the one person who you were like, oh my god, I can't believe I'm actually either A, sharing the stage with this person, or gabbing with them in a dressing room, like
Johnny Cash.
Eh?
Yeah, Johnny Cash. Yeah, it was at Highwayman's show, backstage, I was with Basil. And he was friends with Kris Kristofferson, and we could hear Kris was yelling, "Where's Basil? Where's Basil?" And Basil, he didn't get impressed too much, but he was impressed by that.
Yeah.
And as he's kind of looking for Kris, and Kris is looking for him, along our path comes Johnny and June. And so Basil stuck his hand out, and he said, I'm a huge fan. I'm honored to meet you." And shook Johnny's hand, and I'm right behind him.
Yeah, give
and
me
I
some
said,
of that.
I said, "I'm a huge fan. I'm honored to meet you." I said exactly
what he said.
I didn't know what to say. And both of us afterwards were like, "Oh my god! oh my God, did you feel the electric current go through your hand? Yeah. Oh my God, oh my God. So,
but it, you know, I think that's important. That so it's like that for anyone. People like at any level of the industry are always thrilled by somebody, you know, and it still has that effect. And like, we're big believers in the power of music. It has so much more of in its mandate and so much more in its potential than I think it's being used. You know, if you have to march an army across a continent, you're going to do it to a, to a song. You know, if you're going to make love to your sweet everything, it's going to be to music. If you're going to, you know, launch a, you know, a dream or a ship, it's going to be to music.
Yeah, that's true.
Do you see, I mean, looking at it, because you've got a fairly good, unique perspective, what has happened to the music industry as something that is good, or is it something that is terrible, or a little bit of both?
You know what? I don't know, Kevin. I don't really know. I'm not that involved in the industry as that used to be. I think my last, now I'm really active in what I do, and I feel very much a part of the scene. But I think that industry, the way it used to exist when I was in it, doesn't exist anymore.
No.
As far as I know. So I'm not sure what is going on. I feel lucky that I got independent way before all that shit happened, truly. Yeah. Now, I did that. That was sort of not on my own accord. It was just the way things worked out, that I, you know, just wanted more control, wanted to make my own records. I, you know, really old school, right? At the end of the gig, I want that money in my hand, man. Give me the, like, that was one thing that, you know, when more people were involved in my career, I could not get used to that, where I'm like, I need that, you know?
And that's what I was alluding to, because you seem to be pretty fearless as far as taking on new challenges and not pigeonholing yourself or not being kind of kept to one particular discipline or genre, and being able to promote yourself and being able to kind of see yourself in the big picture, and being, you know, kind of like fiercely independent, and you have to put these burdens on your own back. Yeah. But you also remember the day when you would get paid and there was a paycheck.
Absolutely.
So you're still saying, you know, I still need to get paid for this. Yeah. Unfortunately, we've got a generation of musicians who I don't think are used to getting paid.
Yeah. I mean, I hear that, and I think I don't quite know how that works, because then I think, well, how do you... I just don't know how that works.
Yeah.
I mean, I know how you don't get paid. Don't get me wrong that way. I just...
how you can sustain
an
industry.
How can you sustain it, you know? I think there's a whole middle part that fell out of the industry. I think that there's people that they have careers. The ones that have big careers, they're pretty famous. We know them. And then there's everybody else. But there used to be this middle thing that you could kind of make a living. I used to know guys that did it on the country circuit. They'd do six-nighters, right? Mm-hmm. Matinees. Now, they were doing, you know, covers or whatever, but there was that whole thing. As far as I know, that's all gone.
Yeah. You know? Well, I believe that everything is cyclical, and we're going to see more houses and more places that live music can be played. And when someone like Ron Hines would come through, there'd be people who would have house parties all over Ontario.
Yeah.
And he would do all right for himself because there's always going to be a core of great music fans like Stacey Earle and Mark Stewart. When they come out, there's people who will put them up.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think that's great. And social network, it's something I've taken to, like a duck to water. You've done too.
Yeah, you have to.
Yeah, in this day and age, this is what you have
to do. It's really foolish if you don't, I think. You're foolish if you're in music and you don't take advantage of it.
Yeah. Speaking of which, the new Twitter account. I actually got off my buttocks and I've been resisting it. You think I've been like the master of the 146 word spiel, but it was always seemed to be such a screaming phone booth of idiots that I didn't really get into. I have the three Twitter accounts. I did one for Barbershop Podcast, so you can find us on Twitter at Barbershop Podcast or hashtag
No, it's the at symbol.
Oh, it's the at symbol.
Yeah,
at, it's podcast it's barber.
At podcast barber.
They chose that for us.
Oh, there
yeah.
you go.
Yeah, thanks, yeah. Twitter.
They do, eh? Ryan's disappointed.
No, I love it.
It's good. Come check it out. You know, yeah. I'm very proud of it. It took me a good 45 minutes.
Yeah, and it's, you know, we'll do all the same updates as we do on Facebook, but... You know. In 140 characters or less.
And it's all cross promotion, you know. You yeah. love someone, you love something, you tell hey, your hey, friends.
If you follow us, we'll follow you. How
yeah.
about that?
Yeah, and get the word out, and this episode and all the other ones will be accessible through the Twitter account.
Yes, so. And extras. Maybe we'll do some Twitter exclusive stuff.
Some bonus stuff.
Bonus Twitter content.
Well, speaking of content, I want to play one more tune off of... Well, I'm actually going to play two, but right now I'm going to play Sweetheart Avenue off of that one. That's a rockin' little number.
Yeah, yep.
All right. So we're going to play off of Breaking Point, again from 1994. This is Sweetheart Avenue from Laurie Yates at barbershoppodcast.com. Sweetheart Avenue, Laurie Yates, barbershoppodcast.com. You still like to rip it up, don't
you?
Yeah,
for sure.
So is the live performance still as much of a thrill for you as the early days?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I love it.
Yeah, it's very few totally. People. I don't think there's anyone who's ever come in and said, no, you know, I just only want to play in the studio, right?
I often tease that I need a Murphy bed on stage. Yeah. So I can lay down and sing occasionally, but no.
It's like the people that you meet and you get to play with, there's a different flavoring on your music every time you sit down and you collaborate with other people. What's that been like in kind of growing your connections here in Hamilton and the music community?
Hamilton's been great. Hamilton's just a fertile bed of talent, you know, and creativity and support, really. It's it's pretty wide open. I find I've had some great, you know, collaborations. I play in a band with Chris Houston and Buckshot Beebe, right? The Evelyn Dix. And it's been a great kind of learning experience playing with them. You know, I knew Chris from years ago, but when he moved back to town, I was really thrilled to kind of hook up with him.
Yeah. He was great on the show. Both of them have been on the show, and Chris is so intelligent and so interesting. And his wry observations, like I could just listen to him crack on people all night because he hits a nail on the head quite frequently. It's not an easy town, but like you said, it's a supportive town. Like no one's going to hand you anything, but it's good in the long process if you stick it out.
Yeah, well, you know, what I found was that I came to town and met a few people. Mostly I was, you know, in mommy jail doing the mom thing. And it was when I started to play at the old Corktown and it was voted best skid bar, right? When I started to play there for matinee, then I made tons of friends. And not from people that were there, but more, I think the idea was, oh, she's not a diva, right? Look where she's playing it. Like, this girl just wants to sing, right? Yeah. So I suddenly the doors were open wide at that point.
Now, another thing I want to touch on, I recently did a songwriting workshop that you put together. And one of the things I took out of it is, it's a really hard thing to do part-time. If you're going to be a songwriter, it's really tough to kind of shoehorn it in between 10 other things. Mm-hmm. For you, were there ever like an extended period of time where it just wasn't happening for you?
Yes. Yes, I've been quite a while in between records there, Kevin.
Yeah. But were you still trying to do the little things to kind of keep the...
You know, I get distracted. That's my problem. I mean, I wish I was more of a methodical workhorse. I really do. Where I'd be like, okay, every year we're putting out a record, whether you feel it or not, or inspiration. I don't work like that. I'm much more... artistic temperament, I guess. I've got to feel it. I've got to be in that zone. And, you know, life gets in the way, right? Kids, jobs, bills, all that stuff, it gets in the way. It's necessary. I'm grateful and thankful for all that stuff. You know, you do. You have to kind of zone in on it, concentrate on it to get your batch of songs and get them out there.
Yep, throw that muse in the back of the taxi and
keep, you know, I've been back in it lately and really even, you know, I started this songwriting workshop, but it's really inspired me because the level of talent that's walking into my living room is kicking my ass, right?
Yeah.
And really hearing kind of, you know, when you're given homework every week, you actually complete the songs, right? Left to your own devices, you might not.
And everyone's getting the same homework, and to see everyone's interpretation.
Yeah, totally.
I mean, I didn't look at it from that perspective until now, but it must have been kind of really, you know, not only inspiring, but enlightening to see, you know, boy, you know, that's something that I didn't consider. Because we do kind of fall into our own habits.
Yeah.
Again, I want to get back to some more music. We play... another live one for us?
Yes, I'll try and not have a guitar fall off my lap this time.
that's why we put the strap on.
Let's see what's going to happen this time. Maybe I'll write a song as we go. I might just do that too.
Right here from Box Hill Studio, Laurie Yates coming to you live.
This is one that I cut that night with Marty Stewart playing mandolin. So you can just envision him here with that big hair and his high heel boots. And his big ass smile. And suddenly it's got a whole different groove. Let's see. Cowboy, where are you going?
Are you out tonight under the midnight sky? Cowboy, what you doing? Have you left another woman to cry? Out under the stars, you let the cool night wash over you. You close your eyes and listen to the crows cry. Cowboy, come home, come on home. Cowboy, if you're tired of the wildlife of chasing, promise you can hold. Cowboy, oh, you search for that one light, the one that always leads you
Laurie Yates here at barbershoppodcast.com. Such a thrill.
There's nothing like that red light, Kev.
Nothing like it, eh? You got to rise to the occasion, eh?
Yeah, oh yeah.
It's like a chartreuse spinner on a cold northern lake.
It's true. I'm like, oh, suddenly I swallowed and my voice has gotten weird. Great. That's great.
We're going to get to the 2001 release and talk a little bit about kind of like mini little supergroups, Hey Stella, that was put together. And you mentioned Basil Donovan, the bass player from Blue Rodeo. And I always remember a piece I saw, and I think they were talking to Jim Cuddy, and they were also working at the post office at the time. And I'm not sure if it was Outskirts or when... Something hit, and like you said, they were able to quit their job. And he talked about that last 6 months to a year of still working when you know what it feels like to be on that stage, and how it ruins you, where it's like, you know, this is what I meant to do. So were you mingling quite a bit on the Queen Street scene with Blue Rodeo when they were?
No, I actually wasn't. They were before us, before me. I might have met them, but I didn't really hang out with them at that point. It was I met those guys at the Canadian Country Music Awards in Ottawa, and it was me, Katie Lang, them, and Prairie Oyster. We were kind of like the alternative country folks, along with, you know, Anita Paris and Ronnie Prophet, Michelle Wright, George Fox. They were the traditional kind of old school
country
and
people,
and we were the ruffians, the grimy little punks from Queen Street. And especially with me in that group of people, not the Queen Street people, but the establishment, their attitude towards me was, you know, who the hell are you? Where'd you come from? And, you know, you haven't paid your dues and you got a big American. Like, they were really shitty to me.
Really?
They were pretty friggin' nasty.
They thought that you were a prima donna just being parachuted in?
They didn't think I was a prima donna. They couldn't figure out how I got there.
Gotcha.
And who the hell are you? The only one that was nice to me. Backstage, they were all freaking nasty. George Fox, I'm naming them. Carol Baker. They were nasty. They were unfriendly. Michelle Wright was always friendly. But the one who really, it was Lucille Starr. You know, quand dit soleil dit bonjour au matin. Yeah, loved her. And she was there. And I went up to her and, oh, Miss Starr, I'm such a big fan. Do you know, my name's Laurie Yates. And she said, oh, I know who you are. I'm following your career. And she goes, you come and sit with me. And I was like, okay.
Nice.
Because it was really, there was a really fiercely unfriendly vibe going on.
You know,
on.
And it's sad because you see it in a lot of markets and a lot of disciplines in mm-hmm. that when you really should be sharing and promoting and helping each other. People look at there's one plate of food and, yeah. and someone else is coming in and threatening my portion of the food and not realizing, hey, we can maybe have more food and then, you know, it'd be better if we work together.
It's jealousy, I think. Yeah. Or not even jealousy. I think it's
egos.
Ego, insecurity. It's a little bit like the old guard welcoming the new guard. Well, you know what? If you stick around long enough and you're playing long enough like I have, you have to welcome new people because they need to be here to keep it invigorated, right?
Yeah, and I didn't think the Canadian alt-country scene was as quite as derivative pop as the American one was. I didn't see that same mm-hmm. rush to commercialize at the expense of, I don't know if you would say traditionalism, but, you know, it just seemed like, to me, raised on certain types of music, country didn't enter into it because, although I Hee Haw and the Don Messer and those things were on when I was a kid, it was fading. And then when the new country came out, I'd already had my kind of preferences and allegiances. And it wasn't until those Queen Street crossover bands mm-hmm. kind of came in that I started listening to, you know, going in and say, oh, Hank Snow, and, you know, pulling and these records out and saying, okay, because they mentioned that was an influence, now I want
to. Of course. Yeah, it was youthful. Is what it was. It was youthful, right?
So tell me about Hey Stella and how that project came together.
Well, Hey Stella was me, Basil Donovan, David Baxter, and Michelle Joseph. I played with all of them, different configurations of bands. Baxter had been my guitar player for years. Basil had been my partner for years. And then by the time Hey Stella came around, we were friends. And it was just a kind of a musical thing, you know, great band on stage,
incredible players too.
Yeah, it was always I'd always say it's like singing with a great big machine behind you. Like you gotta know how to sing with that thing behind you because they're just like they're like pit bulls, right? Yeah. Great band on stage, terrible off stage, just terrible. Like the four of us would form a fifth person that was just an ugly son of a bitch. Like just
you absolve yourself of any personal responsibility.
The vibe was just terrible. Like literally, we hadn't even toured, we hadn't even done a whole bunch, but we got to the point where we'd walk in, we wouldn't even, you know, practically we're taking different cabs to the gig. Like just, but on stage there was a magic always.
Yeah. So I want to spin something off of that great Dan Lanois to The Messenger. Yeah. It was mostly covers, a couple originals on it.
Yeah.
It was just a case of like, listen, this band sounds so good together. We need to get something out there.
Well, you know what it was is that band, it came about this club owner named Ted Footman called me and I wasn't playing. I don't know what I was doing, but I wasn't playing. And I think it was after my trip hop record went belly up. I was kind of like, what am I going to do? And he called me and he's like, Laura, you got to sing. You know, and I'm like, I'm not so sure. And he's like, yeah, come and, you know, I'll give you my club free. You can just rehearse there. And he said, I'll give you a Thursday night gig, you know, every Thursday and put a band together. And what about Hey Stella? Even though it wasn't Hey Stella, but what about these guys? So I haven't played with them for a while, so that's how that came about. And my idea was, you know, I was sick of my own songs, sick of my own thing, right? I just wanted to sing great songs. Mm-hmm. I didn't care who wrote them. So that's why there were so many covers to begin with Hey Stella, and then we just recorded kind of how we sounded.
Yeah, if you can get your hands on this is a great CD, a lot of great recordings, and a lot of great songs that you're going to definitely recognize from your life and your journey. But this one, again, from the great Canadian, great local boy, great producer, engineer, and music guy in general. This is The Messenger off of Hey Stella at barbershoppodcast.com.
Got a letter from a man. there's so much work to do.
The Messenger off of 2001's Hey Stella. And again, another little document on your journey, your musical tapestry, as it were. It continues on. You don't stop writing, you don't stop playing. It's nice to see you continue to play around town and stay active. Is there anything as far as what you're doing now with an eye on what you want to do tomorrow that's exciting you right now, or
well, I'm back in the studio, right? I've been very inspired by the songwriters group, so I'm getting my ass kicked too, and I'm writing a lot. So I'm demoing with the idea of, you know, CD in the next 6 months, for sure. No more farting around for Lori Yates.
Do you compile like a whole whack of songs and then go in there and then start culling them?
Yeah. I know with the Book of Minerva, I probably had 40 songs to choose from, which was the first time I'd had that many. You know, it used to be I would just go with what I had. Now, you know, I tell writers, have lots to choose from, you know, because it may even be that once you get in there, it doesn't, you don't cut it the way it sounds, it doesn't turn out right, you know, it's different. Yeah. So the more you have to choose from, the better, I think.
Do you have a problem, like, knowing when it's done, or are you pretty confident in saying, you know, that's it?
Well, the process that happened before I had to stop it, like it was like flowing like a river. Every time I picked up the guitar, a complete song was falling out. It was fantastic. I can't even tell you, right? Yeah. And I had to stop it to record because after I did stop it, I thought, oh no, I should never have done that. I should have just kept riding with it, you know, until it wore itself out. But I did stop it.
Well, you know, I had a pleasure to go down Pine Street Studios, and it's a wonderful facility, and that whole area again, mm-hmm. Picks and Sticks, Lock Street. It's bustling with some creative individuals, people working together, and I'm going to have to ask you if you'll play one more song for us.
Sure,
I will. And dedicated to Ryan and I on this occasion.
I'll dedicate it to you guys. Thanks for having me.
It's
so sweet. Am I the first one in the new studio?
Yeah, we had the 1-year anniversary show, but you're the first one in this configuration.
Cool. All right.
So we are pleased as punch.
All right. Well, come out and hang out with me at some gig and we'll sing some
reminisce.
Song. I'm not the kind of woman who likes to put down a feat or make commitments to obligations I couldn't keep. Now, honey, don't you know wherever you go, I'll be loving you. I'll be loving you. And when the snow, Lord, it begins to blow, and the distance between us, it grows and it grows. Keep it in mind, I won't leave you behind. No, I'll be loving you. I'll be loving you. I'll be loving you until I lose my desire. I'll be loving you until hell runs out of fire. I think I screwed that one up too. I'm such a factory-trained professional, and I care so much. Cowboy Jack now is looking down on me. He's hissing. Shh. Girl, you're getting all hyped up on your voice. Okay, last verse. I'm not the kind of woman who gives her heart away to the first pretty face that comes my way. Keep it in mind, you're the first in line. Yeah, I'll be loving you. Whoa, I'll be loving you. Oh yes, I will. I'll be loving you. Ooh, I'll be loving you. Ba 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 da ba da da da. Bom 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 bom.
Right here, Boxo Studio, Ms. Laurie Yates with the good stuff. You mentioned and you touched on Mummy Jail. We're going to play a tune off of the Book of Minerva. Tell me about that process and that CD, because it sounds like it was maybe at the end of a period where you hadn't been working.
Yeah. Well, it was around the time that I was playing at the Corktown, so I was doing the matinees there, and the pool players were threatening my life on a weekly basis. Did you ever come down to those gigs?
Yeah,
you did.
Yeah.
So the pool players, like, you know, usually musicians, we make friends with the, you know.
Yeah, I think it was free pool at the time.
They were rough, man. Like I mean, yeah, they were scaring me, and they were getting kind of nasty. But I was writing a lot and able to play them right out of my living room. So Had the idea that I wanted to make a really stripped down record of just really my voice, guitar, and a little bit of instrumentation. Went to Mike Berthelmer's place at Pine Street Studios, got on his beautiful mic, and it was like, holy crap, man, it sounded so good immediately. I never had heard my voice like that. Like, usually, you know, I was fighting with the producer, you know, or just fighting for it to sound good. And he just, like, did something, and I'm like, Mike, what'd you do? And he's like, Lori, I didn't do anything, it's completely dry. Mm-hmm. I'm like, wow. So it took all these years to get here.
Yeah, get back to zero.
Right? Yeah. Totally. So started going in there and demoing a bunch of songs and thinking that I could make a really sparse record. And at first, I know it was a little, I didn't freak him out, but like him and David Baxter and different musicians that I'd worked with were really unsure of my idea. But I had this pretty clear idea about what I wanted to do with it. So
it came out the way you liked.
It came out exactly as I wanted, yeah.
Well, this is a story from the heart, something that, you know, I was in daddy jail, but I certainly know exactly what you're talking about. It's off of 2006, The Book of Minerva. I'm breaking out of mommy jail. Lori Yates at barbershoppodcast.com.
My baby boy is tugging at my shirt. I'm already half an hour late for work. Can't find a clean cup anywhere, or a comb to fix my little girl's hair. And I've had just about enough. Tonight I'm breaking out of mommy jail. I've been fighting tooth and nail for a little bit of freedom to call. Don't get me wrong, I love my kids. Without them, I wouldn't want to live. But I need some time alone. Tonight I'm breaking out of mommy jail. I've been fighting tooth and nail for a little bit of freedom to call.
Hallelujah, indeed. I'm breaking out of mommy jail. Little sweet thing from Lori Yates. It's been a thrill having you in a barbershoppodcast.com. We had a great show a few weeks ago with Dwayne Rutter when he came in and mentioned how he grew up in the shadow of the Danko clan. And, you know, I've got a friend who lives out in Woodstock, and he's a vet, and that's why he moved to Woodstock. And he has other friends who live in Woodstock because they knew that this is the area, you know, that gave birth and sustained so many of these great musicians. A lot of people don't know that, but off of 94's Breaking Point, Rick Danko sang with you on
he
that
sure
album.
Did, yep.
So tell me how that come about.
Well, you know, it was in Bearsville, and Colin was hanging out with Rick a lot at that time. So I had written this song called Rebel Angel that was about Handsome Ned, who was kind of the big alt-country guy on Queen Street who had died. So the song is about the night he died of a heroin overdose. It was a nice, light little topic, you know. You know, we wanted to get some harmony on it, and I don't remember how it came up. I don't remember how Rick's name came up. Basil was there with me. Basil knew Rick as well, and I had met Rick once before in New York through Basil, but there he was. Suddenly there he was, and he was singing.
So you were in the studio when he was singing,
absolutely.
And it wasn't the sort of thing that was mailed to you after?
Yes,
wonderful.
Yes, yeah. It was pretty amazing.
Yeah, it's a treat for the years, and
oh, yeah.
Guess what? You're going to get to hear it here at barbershoppodcast.com. Ryan can't wait. We want to get it to you. Here we go. From 94's Breaking Point, Rebel Angel, barbershoppodcast.com.
There's not much left.
Laurie Yates here at barbershoppodcast.com. Well, she may not have been from here, but she's ours now. So thrilled to have her here in Hamilton. If you get a chance to see Laurie live, I highly recommend that you do it. Her links are going to be on the page. Download some of her music, buy them, they're available all over the place. Girl, it's been such a pleasure having
you
in the studio.
Thank you for having me, guys. I love your show. You know I do.
Yeah, it's been great. It's going to continue to be great. Yep. We're going to bring people in each and every week that inspire me like you
Absolutely.
Do. And I walk away going, God damn it, I can hardly wait till next week. Cool. Which, by the way, we've got Trick Bag in the studio. Yeah, and they're going to do a special hopped up acoustic set for us. These are guys that you're going to want to check out. They've been on the scene for a long time for damn good reason. Thrilled to have them in here. Ryan, once again, good work here.
Hey, thank you.
Thanks
for
Ryan.
Keeping the ship going straight.
Yeah, you know, I do my best. It's a lot. You know, it's smooth sailing now that we got new equipment. I've been begging for this for months, but yeah, it's a good setup now. Yeah, it's nothing. No more technical issues at Barbershop Podcast.
Yeah, well, we'll do something about that. We'll get some new stuff. Yeah. That's true.
I'm sure I'll fuck something up, but yeah, it's not going to be the equipment's fault anymore.
No. No, it's been great.
Yeah.
It's been great. All right. Well, next week, we're going to check you out every Wednesday night. 8
o'clock. We should probably give a shout out to our sponsor, too, before we go.
Again,
Picks and Sticks.
Picks
Thank
and
you.
Picks and Sticks on Lock Street. Jamie and everyone down there helped us out with a little percussion help last week.
Yeah.
Shaking each other's hands, promoting the good
cajon.
People doing good work. Cajon. So we have a large cajonies now here in the studio. Thanks to Jamie at Picks and Sticks.
Yep.
Visit him. Give me your business. All the good people here in Hamilton and all around the world.
Yay.
Thanks for coming out.
Bye.